So good evening everybody. We will start now. We discussed about the organic practices and methods used. And today we will discuss about the organic cultivation. So mostly this is not useful for everyone, but some knowledge you may get about the general practices, the general concepts and how it is operating in India, the overall concept and legal framework working in India. So just I will share the screen now. So can you hear me now? Is there any problems?
It's coming a little broken, sir.
So is it okay now with the voice? So we will start now. So I am sharing the screen now. If you can see the slide, please confirm it. So can you see the screen now, the slide now? Hello. Hello. Okay, then we will start now, no issue. This is about the organic certification. So this is as per the NPOP standard. NPOP means National Program for Organic Production in India. This was set up in 2002 by the central government. So under the Ministry of the Commerce and Agriculture. So now it's operating under the Ministry of Commerce, and Ministry of Commerce has set up the committee called National Accreditation Body, NAB. So the committee then will appoint the evolution committee. That is the committee constituted by different boards like coffee board, tea board, spices board. Like that, there is the Marine Products Development Authority. Yeah, and similarly there are 6 to 8 boards. So these are the committee members for the evolution committee, and the NAB has also appointed APEDA. APEDA, you may know, that is export to monitoring agency, that agriculture and processing products export development authority in India. It's the IDAPIS is in New Delhi. So they are the secretary to the NPOP. They will monitor the NPOP policy and regulations and its implementation in India. So NPOP mainly is operated through central government, and the APEDA will then appoint the private agencies. They will give the license to private agencies for providing certification services in India. So those who are interested, they will apply to NAB. Then NAB will review the application, and they will grant the certification license to the certification body. So though there are Presently, in 2002, it was 2007-8. There are only few agencies. Those are all foreign agencies. Now there are 30, almost 30 accredited, licensed accreditation bodies operating in India. This is briefly about the NQOP. And there is another local marketing standard, that is PGS system, Participatory Guarantee System. This PGS system was established in 2015. Up to 2015, it was NPOP because NPOP only covers the export policies. It will not cover much about the local domestic markets. So that's why PGS was started to address the local marketing issues. So this PGS is monitored by the Ministry of Agriculture Cooperation. The Ministry of Agriculture Cooperation has appointed NCOF, National Center for Organic Farming. The NCOF is in it's in Ghaziabad, and it has 7 regional bodies in India. So PGS is operated by the NCOF, and PGS, the NCOF will appoint the regional councils. The structure is it will accredit the regional councils, similar to the NQOP. PGS is operated through the regional councils, RCs, in India. There are almost thousands of RCs. Those who are interested, they will get the recognition as RC. And they will monitor the PGS certification. PGS certification is very limited, and it is only applicable for the local marketing certification, and it is legally recognized for certification. So these are the two standards now operating in India. So there are other standards. This is what we are following in India. So similarly, the American people, they have their own standard, that is called the NOP, National Organic Program, that is monitored by the United States Department of Agriculture. So similarly, European countries, they follow their EU regulations, and they have their council, and they will monitor the certification. Like that, even Japan, they have their own standard. Canada, they have their own standard. Canadian organic standard, Japanese organic standard, like that, the Korean organic standard. So few countries, they have their own countries, and those countries, those who don't have their own standard, they follow normally NOP only, National Organic Program. And in Europe, the EU standards are almost equivalent to the NPOP. And if you are getting the NPOP certification, it's equivalent to the European countries. That means you can, if you are certified with the NPOP, you can export all the products to European countries, and they will accept it if you have a NPOP certificate. Only for the fresh products, not for the processed products. If you are processing again and exporting to Europe, so then you have to take the separate EU certification. That is separate, you have to look for the EU certification. This is the legal framework operating in India for organic food production and export. There are also private standards BioSwiss and Demeter. It was a standard. BioSwiss is now operating, and Crown. There are some more standards also, Rainforest Alliance. So there are only few people they opt for these private standards also. So this is brief about the organic certification process in India. So NPOP, as I told, it started in 2001-2002, and it's mainly focused on the certification of individual farming activity, and also because our India is mainly consist of farmers who are very small, and group certification is popular in India. In Asian countries only we can see the group certification. So NQP covers the crop production. Crop production involves individual farmer certification and group certification. And also processing. If you are there is a commercial processing, some companies are taking up then they have to take the separate certification for processing. If someone is trading and exporting, then there is a separate certification for trading and exporting. And there is, if there is a forest collection, like soap nut or some forest products, if they are collecting some herbs, like the honey, wild honey, then they have to take the certification under wild collection. There is also a separate certification. And recently, there are few more schemes added, like livestock. Livestock meat, organic meat production also included, organic egg, organic milk. So certification, there was no certification up to 2015 or something. So now they have included livestock feed and fodder, milk, meat and egg production, poultry, aquaculture, and similarly like apiculture also. Someone is doing commercial apiculture, if they want to go for organic, there are certain rules they have to follow, and that is also included. So you can search in Google about the NPOP manual. It's almost a 250 page manual available in Google. So there is some standards available. It has almost 6 chapters. Chapter 1 is about the introduction, same thing, whatever I explained, it will be there in chapter 1. Chapter 2 is about the legal framework, and chapter 3 about the general standards we are discussing now, chapter 3, and chapter 4 is about the accreditation procedures, and chapter 5 is group certification, chapter 6 is use of the organic logo. So like we will discuss the most of them now. So this is the basic information, and India is number 1 in terms of the number of producers. So it is so now 7th or 9th place in terms of the area in the world. So this is the there is chapter 3 in NPOP, that is called NSOP, National Standards for Organic Production. So it covers the important the requirements, like basic requirements for crop production. So land conversion requirements, land, if someone is going from chemical to organic, and if it is they're going for certified organic, because there is a lot of difference between what is organic and what is certified organic. So whoever following organic, if they want to go for certification, then that is different. What if they are just using the organic manures? It's not that is not enough. There are other rules they have to follow. So once they follow all these rules, then only it is called a certified organic. So all farmers can be organic, but all farmers cannot be certified organic. So there are some requirements they have to follow, and then only they will be considered as certified organic. So there is first requirement is land conversion requirements. So in this it states that if someone is going for a chemical to organic, so there is some time period required, that is called conversion period. It is usually 2 years for annual crops. If someone is growing annual crops, it is 2 years, and if someone is growing perennial crops, it will be 3 years. So the conversion period is required so that farmers will stop using the chemicals and they will start using the organic elements, to restore the soil organic matter. That is the main principle. During the conversion period, farmers will be monitored for their farming activities. They have to maintain the records, and based on the their practices, they will be given the status, conversion status. We call that conversion period 1. That is conversion CS1, C2, like that. Conversion 1, conversion 2, second year is called as conversion 2. Then it will be for annual crops. If there are there are perennial crops, then C3 will be there, and then organic. This is the process involved. Then source of seed and planting materials, as we discussed also. So seed should be almost one seeds, one farm saved, or some conventional seeds also they can be used, or even hybrids can be used. But the condition is they should not be chemically treated. So chemically treated seeds are prohibited, and also GMO seeds. It is genetically modified. There are some seeds which, because that is explained in day one, some seeds they may be like in cotton, they have introduced some genes to prohibit the pest attack. That is, those crops are not on. Even they tried in brinjal, they are trying in many crops, we may not know. Those crops are not allowed in organic agriculture, even in milk also, cows. So then there should be measures for contamination control, that we will discuss what are the contamination sources farmer has to identify, and they have to take the measures to minimize the risk of contamination from the chemical fields. If someone is doing organic, they have to prevent contamination from their neighbor fields. If they are doing chemical, then they have to protect their organic field. The nutrient management, yesterday we discussed about the nutrients, the sources of nutrients, and what is allowed, what is not allowed. That is, the farmer has to get the knowledge, and they have to adopt a nutrition program. And then weed, pest, and disease management. This is also we will discuss. So weeds, so they should be prevented at early stage only. So before their flowering, they have to be destroyed, and they can be used as mulch material, or some they can be composted. And also pest and diseases, we discussed about some preventive measures. So they have to adopt biodiversity, and these we will discuss one by one. And biodiversity, soil and water conservation, this is also we have discussed, we will discuss now also. And handling and value addition, storage and transport, storage and transport also, there should be separate measures. Organic foods should be separately labeled when they are transported, and they should be sufficiently packed to avoid the mixing contamination. Then processing, packing, labeling, export, all this we will discuss in brief. So basic standards, there shall be a documented procedure. If someone is going for organic certification, the first thing is it should be recorded, and there should be the documented procedures available. Everything we cannot depend on the oral communication. Farmers will tell all the things like they are very good, they are following everything perfectly, they are using good inputs, but this is because this is only one visit per year. No one can ensure any visit. That's why farmer has to maintain everything. Like if they are purchasing some inputs, they should maintain the bills, purchase bills, the type of inputs they used. They have to maximum, they should retain the label. If they are using the bottle should be, the after use, they should be kept for verification. Like that, there are some requirements. Everything should be recorded. Then discussed about the conversion period. So conversion period, as I told, it's 24 months for the annual crops and 36 months for the perennial crops. Someone is applying for organic certification, only after 2 years they will get the organic status. Up to that, they cannot market as organic. This is important, because during that period it's only a conversion period, and that cannot be organic product. Then landscape, this is like landscape means maintaining biodiversity. So they have to go for the, they should avoid the monocropping, and they should adopt the crop rotation, intercropping, multi-cropping, mixed cropping. So they should have some animals to take care of the manure requirement. Like that, there are some requirements. Then seeds and planting, this is simple. They have to maximum use the farm seeds, or some conventional seeds, but there should not be any chemical treatment, because in market most of the seeds will be treated with chemicals like Tehram or Zena, like that. So seed coating with the chemicals is prohibited in organic farming. So inputs they are using for nutrition all should be easily degradable. Yesterday we discussed about it. There is a list available in NPOP. No, someone can refer that list. Simple list, locally available, FYM, compost, these are all directly allowed. Even microbial preparations are allowed, all the microbes are allowed, even cocoa peat is allowed, Most of the plant and animal based products are easily allowed. Mineral based products also should be natural source. Those are allowed. And chemical synthesizer products are not allowed. So this we discussed already. And parallel production, this is important. And if someone is doing part conversion, because in organic, there is farmer can go with part conversion. Like they can, if they have 4 acres, they can do organic 2 acres, and 2 acres with chemical farming is allowed at early stage. But they cannot grow same crop in both the fields, because this cannot be separate. Like there should be clear differentiation between the fields and between the crops. Same variety cannot be grown. Even if they are growing same crop, they should not grow the same variety. This is the requirement. So can you hear? So this is the some requirements. So parallel production is not allowed. Then seeds explained, it's almost same. So organic certified seeds may not be available. They can use the one form saved or conventional seeds, but it has to be treated with cow urine. They can dilute cow urine, and they can soak in cow urine. All the chemicals will be washed, and they can take up the planting or seed treatment with bio fertilizer is also recommended. So fertilization, as we discussed, is all material should be from the plant, animal or microbial source, and they should be easily degradable when applied to the soil. And nutrition program should be well planned to take care of the crop nutrient requirements. There is a crop calendar, we call it as crop calendar. Crop calendar is nothing but the process involved, the important stages of the crops where we must give the sufficient quantity of nutrients so that crops will be they should not feel shortage of the nutrients. So that crop calendar should be planned before the start of the season. For that you have to plan the compost, quantity of compost required, or some quantity of the biofertilizer requirements. Like that are some the quantity of the even the liquid fertilizer, like Jeevamrut. If you are going for 1 acre, then at least 500 liter of Jeevamrut you have to give. Then another time like 1000 liters will be required. Like that it has to be planned before the start of the season, based on the crops. If there are some high cash crops, then nutrient requirement it will be much more. If they are pulses, then nitrogen need not be given. The sources of nitrogen can be avoided. Like that, even over manuring is also prohibited. As per the requirement only, the animals, there is a specific requirement. If for 1 acre, 2 cows are enough. Like that, there is also, it's mentioned in the NPOP manual. So nutrient loss should be minimized, and accumulation of heavy metals, that should be avoided. And for that, there should be sufficient methods to be taken. Non-synthetic mineral fertilizers and brought in biofertilizers shall be regarded supplementary only, because only at initial stage these are required. So once there is sufficiency achieved, these biofertilizers are not required. If we are not using any herbicides or chemical fertilizers for continuously for 2 to 3 years, there is no need to apply even biofertilizers also. So up to that stage you need to apply, so with the restricted quantity also. So there is a restriction for use of the outside farm inputs. Even if it is a biofertilizer, there is a restriction, quantity is restricted. human expertise is not allowed because it may contain the heavy metal. So that's why it is not allowed. Even tobacco is not allowed. Tobacco preparations are not allowed in organic. And like that, there are only few restrictions on synthetic, anything synthetic like urea, DAP, those are straight away not allowed. Even pesticides are not allowed. Pesticide means pure only based on the need based, like copper oxychloride, borax mixture, those are allowed. But based on the requirement, because those are very much required in arecanut or plantation crop to against the fungus diseases. Some chemicals are allowed up to some extent. Even copper sulfate is allowed. Copper is very much required molecule in agriculture. So like that, there are some, those who have traditional bondage, those are already using from the old days, those are allowed. Otherwise, remaining are not allowed. So the modern chemicals are straight away not allowed. So pest and disease and weed management. So we discussed about just these are general principles. Whatever we are discussing today are general principles. So diversity should be maintained, and management practices should be well planned, sufficiently planned, so that the pest population will be minimized. So by adopting the good varieties, disease resistance varieties, and also introduction of the useful microbes and also insects which are useful. Yesterday we already discussed about it. So, and also equipments should be cleanly maintained so that the spread of the disease from other fields is can be prevented. There are some approved inputs. The list is available in the NPOP manual. It's called Annex 2, Appendix 3, Chapter 3. So, thermal sterilization is restricted. Only prior permission has to be taken for if there is a requirement for sterilization of the soil. And use of synthetic dyes and growth regulators are not allowed. They are prohibited. Only natural growth regulators like gibberellic acid, indoleic acid, or ethylene gas is allowed. So synthetic powder like the materials like they will be extracted from chemical source or not. So contamination control, so maximum contamination has to be available because there is no like the purpose will not be served. So there is no proper contamination control measures in the farm, then it is a major threat to the organic integrity. So for that, there should be boundary buffer zone crops on the borders. So like leaf fencing or some raising the bands or even compound walls, fenced wiring. Like that, some measures has to be taken to avoid the air drip of the chemicals or anything, whichever there is a possibility, it has to be avoided. Then plastics has to be removed. They are used in the farm, they has to be removed without a peace in the land. So this is the border of trees in the field, which will avoid the drift or burns. So this will prevent the water flow, free water flow, and also it will separate the two fields. This is only example, but there are still established buffer zones one can ask. So soil and water conservation, this is already thing discussed to prevent the erosion and to because soil we already discussed about day one only. So soil is very precious. It will take even 100 to 500 years for formation of the top layer soil. So that's why it has to be protected by mulching or some good measures. Minimum tillage and also take covering this upper soil with dry materials or some mulching materials. Some people will use plastic mulching also. So any measures which will protect the upper soil is okay. And organic material should not be burning is prohibited in organic farming. Anything burning is totally prohibited, and clearing of the primary forest is also prohibited in organic farming. So these are the general principles. So then these are the steps involved in organic certification. So these are the general steps involved. Submission of the application. So each certification body will be nominated by the APEDA. They will accredit, and there is a list of certification bodies in APEDA website. So those are only allowed to grant the certification in India. So there will be application. Those are more interested. They can request for certification, certificate application. So certification bodies will send application to the interested farmers or some company. So they have to again fill up the application. There are some general requirements. So they have to fill up their farm details and their location, GPS details, and also supporting documents. PAN copy is the compulsory document, and also land records, and crop details. The 1 year plan is to be given in advance. So their approximate yield also expected yield. And if there is any some more details, they can give. So application is very simple, and then based on the application, the certification body, if they have the enough resources, they will send the quotation, because there is a charges for certification, annual charges. Every year it will be renewed. Certification will be renewed every year. So only it is renewed, then only it will be counted as organic. Otherwise, because it's only once in a year, they will monitor the your production system. Remaining all, you have to maintain the documents only. By documentary evaluation only, certificate will be issued. So there is a online system that is called TraceNet. So this is maintained on the APEDA website. So all the data is available in the TraceNet itself, and certificate is also issued through TraceNet only. So they will give the certificate password once registered as an organic farmer. So they will give you the username password, and using username password, you can enter your details, farm details, so extent of the area, crops cultivated, and then inputs used, some of the inputs like that, basic details it will ask. Then it will be forwarded to the certification body. So the certification body, then once receiving the details, they will plan for the physical visit. So they will visit your farm, they will check for the details. You have to maintain a document, that is important document, organic management plan. The department will be given the certification body, that is almost 8 to 10 page document. Entire your plant details will be there, like number of cows in your farm, number of trees, the plots, number of plots, area, acres, and map, your farm map. Like that, it will cover all the details. So based on whatever the information is provided in the organic management plan, so they will take up the physical inspection, and they will prepare the report based on the entropy, whatever we discussed. If you have said that you have one source of organic input, but when they are using, if you are using some other inputs, some outside inputs, then they will raise it as a non-conformity. So whatever you have to disclose everything. If you are hiding something, they will raise the non-conformity. Then you have to reply. You have to close that non-conformity. Then certificate will be issued. That will be valid for 1 year. So if you are not satisfied with the certification decision, you can claim it. You can make an appeal to review the decision, or you can complain to against the decision also. So this is the general procedure involving certification. And also there is a provision for a gold group certificate. So because individual certification is very costly, so some private agencies will charge up to 30,000 per year. Even if it is a 5 acre, 10 acre land, 20,000, 15,000 they will charge. So government agencies, they will charge from 5,000 to 10,000 like that. So if someone is not able to take up individual certification, they can form a group and take up the certification. Group certification, in group certification for farmer, cost would be even as low as 200, 500, like that only. So group certification will be very effective. So the documentation has to be maintained by the mandator. We call it as mandator. So mandate has to take up some sort of even processing units. They will make their own units like sugar cane, sugar production, organic sugar production factories. They will form their own groups, 5 to 10 groups, and they will get certified as a crop production, and then they will purchase the sugar cane and they will process it and export the product. Like that, there are systems even for other products like rice. Basmati rice, non-basmati rice, even oil seed crops, coconut oil. So those companies, they will farm their own groups, coconut producers, and they will procure from them certified products, and they will market as organic. So for group certification, there are some requirements. So legal group should be legally registered, and there should be full traceability required. And also, there is a disconnection. You can rejoin once again. So we will continue. So there shall be established. We call it as internal control system. So this is called as internal control system. There should be some minimum number of staff to maintain the group